Now I want to turn to an issue that preoccupies most nations, that is, our economies. The Industrial Revolution brought scientists, engineers, technologists and entrepreneurs together to apply science to industry and the economy. The result was the steam engine providing power, chemistry and geology improving ceramics and the use of natural resources, mechanics and engineering constructing machines for transport and manufacture. Where would our economy be today without electricity, electromagnetism, electronics, synthetic chemistry, atomic physics, biochemistry, molecular biology, pharmacology? It would be very different. Some say that Michael Faraday answered the Prime Minister of his day when asked what good his inventions of the electric transformer, generator, and motor might be by saying, "Why, Prime Minister, someday you can tax it." It's probable that Faraday never really said that, but the anecdote captures the view of some politicians and business leaders who do not always grasp how science can enhance industrial capabilities and create wealth. So how can we make sure that science thrives and continues to bring benefits to our economy? I strongly argue that the first requirement is to have a high-quality science base. So how can that be achieved? Good science has a tradition of respect for empiricism, reliable observation and experiment, as I've said, and most importantly, needs to be carried out in a culture of openness and freedom without boundaries. The scientific endeavour is at its most successful when creativity is encouraged and there is freedom of thought. Scientists need to be able to express doubts, to be sceptical about established orthodoxy, and incidentally, particularly sceptical about their own ideas, which is more difficult. And they must not be too strongly directed from the top, as that stifles creativity. During the Cold War, Russia was able to build a nuclear bomb and to send the first man to space. Two great achievements, but mostly based on previously known physics. But work requiring new science was rather less fortunate in the Soviet Union. For example, genetics and crop improvement were completely disrupted because, for ideological reasons, Stalin backed Lysenko, who rejected Mendelian genetics, accepted everywhere else in the world. Similarly, in Nazi Germany, Hitler rejected the work of Einstein because it was Jewish physics. Science does not thrive, ultimately, in such societies. For science to flourish, a broad portfolio of research investment is required. There's a continuum of research, ranging from discovery science, through research aimed at translating knowledge for application, onto subsequent innovation and the development of new applications and new technologies. The temptation to invest too heavily in a particular part of this spectrum should be resisted. Sometimes it's argued that we should concentrate only on translation and not on discovery. But that is a mistake. As Sir George Porter, Nobel laureate and president in the past of the Royal Society, said, to feed applied science by starving basic science is like economizing on the foundations of a building so that it may be built higher. It is only a matter of time before the whole edifice collapses. Research often needs a longer timescale than is usual, with the more short-term priorities of private business or, for that matter, of politicians elected on short-term cycles. And this can cause problems with longer-term projects required for translating scientific advances into useful applications. Bridging the often short-term pressures from commerce and politicians with the longer times required to develop discovery research into effective applications is crucial. Perhaps greater collaboration between publicly funded research and private companies can help move science to application by spreading the risk, by allowing longer-term views in private companies. Given the importance of science in our lives, how can we make the best decisions about what research should be supported?
Thank you.